Hey guys, this is Nick at Press Play. Well, the weekend of the 16th, I went to IndieCade East in New York, and in these special features, I wanted to share with you the raw audio interviews I'm using to write my coverage. But keep in mind that these are the original interviews, so they're not as squeaky clean as our official podcasts, but I hope you enjoy this look into my process, and most of all, I hope you enjoy the information. Okay, well, we're at IndieCade East 2013 once again, and I'm talking to David, or Davey, who developed the Stanley Parable. How you doing?
I'm doing excellent. Thank you very much.
So the Stanley Parable is a really interesting game. Well, I'll let you explain it, actually. You explain this game.
Oh, I hate explaining my game. It's the worst thing. I very, very rarely explain my game. It doesn't explain to very much on a conceptual level. It's quite short, and to me it's a game about unraveling sort of little mysteries gradually over time, and so I generally try to say as little as possible about it.
Okay.
But I'll say that it's follows the story of a guy named Stanley in a world of where something he's confronted with something he does not understand. And that there is a story of his life that may or may not be about his life, and that sort of the player's exploration is a discovery of themselves through Stanley. That was really weird and pretentious. I don't even remember what I just said. I think I blacked out there for a minute. You can edit that out if it's all just nonsense.
At some point you started talking in tongues. It was sort of weird.
Yeah,
like,
I'm pretty sure. I think I've begun to bleed somewhere. I can feel like a little chafing, but I'm not sure. That could be something else. We won't bring that up on this.
So something that I found about the game, without going into any story details, of course, it seems like a really specific commentary about video games. I don't know how far you want to go into that without divulging story information, but if you could talk a little bit about how this game sort of explores the idea of player choice.
Well, I mean, it only comes from me having played a lot of video games and just wanting to know what else could I do with them. Like, what very simple, because I didn't have a lot of tools available, or I didn't know how to use the Source engine very well. And so I knew that I had a very limited set of interactions that I knew how to create via these tools. And so I said, okay, well, what very limited interactions can I still make meaningful on that level? And I'm sorry, I'm just like seeing someone. I can't look. I gotta be over here.
Just so you viewers at home know, the game is playing out of speakers like right towards us, so we're getting distracted by watching people play.
I'm like watching people play and like totally like messing it all up. So I'm like, getting all anxious. Now I'm looking at a blank wall, so we got no more worries about that. So what I found was that there's a lot of game mechanics and tropes and mechanisms that you can explore that don't require much a complexity of interaction, that don't require a lot of mechanics. You can actually speak about a lot of tropes in video games, even with just literally like walking forward. You know, like there's still a surprising number of ways that you can interact with the players and allow the players to interact back with very, very limited interactions. And so that was really my challenge, was to take a very limited set of tools and see how much could I dig out of them, how much could I unearth from them, and little tiny ways that people relate to video games.
And so sort of high concept, this game is a Source engine first-person game with a narrator. Can you sort of tell me about the narration and how you write it?
I did. I wrote the narration. It was narrated by another guy named Kevin Brighting, who's a fantastic British voice actor. And the narration guides the story. The narration is the story. The narration is what contextualizes you, the player. It gives you something to understand, something to hold on to, something that keeps you moving forward. And that was really important for me, to root the player initially very strongly in something, in order to then be able to mess with that foundation. foundation that had been laid. So it's important to have a strong foundation through the narration.
And so, if it's okay with you, I would like to do this interview in two parts. The first part to sort of end for anyone who hasn't played the game,
sure.
And the second part to sort of talk spoilers.
That's fair. We can get dirty. We can do a little dirty interview here. Yeah.
All right. Getting a little explicit on the Press Play podcast. This is a family show, sir.
That's how I roll. After hours, not for kids.
I don't know where you are. It's like 6 o'clock where we're talking right now, but
it won't be by the time we get to part two.
But I mean, for anybody who's interested in the game and sort of exploring, you know, how you can experience a narrative in a game, where can they pick this up?
Oh, you can Google Stanley Parable. It's on ModDB is where it's primarily hosted, and it's for Mac or PC. You have to have Steam. Although if you do have it on Mac, you have to own Half-Life 2 because it's a Half-Life 2 mod. On PC, there's workarounds. And so as long as you have Steam, you can just plug it into your Steam account.
Very cool. So anybody who hasn't played the game, check it out. And then tune into part two of the podcast. If you have played the game, just keep listening. Because we're going to talk now. The first sort of moment, the inciting incident, if you're talking about it in screenplay terms, is you turn around and you walk out of a room and you're presented with two doors. And the narrator says, go through the left door. Automatically, just because I'm the type of player who always looks for clues and stuff on the non-correct path, correct in quotes, so I immediately went to the right door, and it just closed behind me. That's sort of a common theme throughout the game. Can you sort of, elaborate on that?
What, the closing of doors behind you? Or the
closing of doors behind you and the punishment for doing so.
Well, I mean, it's not a punishment. You chose to do it, right? I mean, like, own it. You know, like that's what you wanted to do. The closing of doors is really just because I don't want to have to deal with all of the implications of people going back through certain things. I mean, the game, like, there's no secret about it. The game is very linear in a certain sense. You know, it's very heavily authored. Like, even though the narrative branches, it's like, I mean, you kind of just walk forward. You know, you more or less, you just kind of walk forward and see the nice stuff. And the closing of doors is just, you know, my way of saying, hey, you're on my track here. Whatever you do, you're going to be walking down and experiencing my story, and I'm not making a thing out of that other than to say, no, I want you to experience this particular set of story elements. And if you make that choice to go down that path, then own it, you know, and go all the way.
Right. But and to get a little bit more philosophical, I guess, or to talk about sort of the story of the game, I mean, the narrator himself sees himself as punishing you for not doing what he's saying. And, you know, you can sort of determine whether you're punishing yourself based on which endings you're getting or all that stuff, because there are multiple endings in the game. Sort of tell me about, a little more specifically, what you're saying through this narrator and some of the specifics.
I believe that the nature of the narrator defies specific interpretation of who he is. I want the narrator to be a reference point for people to understand. The narrator is a reference point for the player's attempt to understand and congeal meaning out of the world around them. You know, the narrator makes sense, so to speak. He is logical. He moves forward. He reduces events into a single frame of story through which you walk singularly to experience what is on the other side. It's important, like I said, with the narration being a context for, you know, that a foundation to later be subverted. I want the narrator to so embody a sense of forward moving directed storytelling that he becomes unreliable. He's so far in that direction that he is utterly, utterly without any sort of grounding. He has no real power. He has no real strength. He's so completely in that direction that he's lost his ability to actually be inherently meaningful. And I only want him to exist insofar as players see their own meaning making through him, that they see in themselves their own tendencies to form habits and patterns and to try to synthesize meaning out of events. Because if you do that in yourself, and if you see where the narrator is fallible, not specifically who or what he is, but that he is fallible and that he can be broken and faulted and made wrong and can be torn down, and if you see yourself in him, then it turns it back on you and asks about the faults in your own meaning making.
Wow.
That was a really interesting and concise answer, sort of without, you know, going too specific about the narrator, but I'm impressed, sir.
You want specifics, though.
I was asking about really specific stuff, but right. I mean, that's about as specific as you can get without being the artist who says, like, here's the answer to my question. I prefer what you have just done to what a lot of people do, where they say, like, this is a definitive answer, you know?
And at that point, I'm just describing my game, because I think that the game speaks for itself in that way. I mean, I could tell you, like, you know, the narrator thinks that he is killing Stanley, but actually there's a female narrator who's killing Stanley, right? Or is she really the one who's killing Stanley? I mean, that's what happens. The subtext there is the narrator was so sure that he was right. The narrator believed that he was killing Stanley, right? And the narrator is a series of voice clips of waves in a game file, right? And as by leaving the game running, you're only just letting wave files continue to run, you know? But you made that meaning. You, the player, made that meaning. If you see the cracks in the narrator through that, it's the cracks in your own attempt to create meaning where there really wasn't any.
So, I mean, you're talking about the narrator as a character and sort of his motivations. And so in terms of a commentary on game narration or on a game trying to lead a player in a certain specific way or letting him go, you know, what games do you feel have succeeded or failed in that field?
Oh, man, I have been talking all weekend with people about The Walking Dead, right? Okay. Have you played it?
Yes.
Yeah. Because it's a pretty amazing, synthesis of giving players a lot of choice and letting people really determine a lot of little things about the game while simultaneously funneling everything back into the exact same storyline. And it can do that, but I felt the content was so good that I really felt the emotional impact of those connections, you know? So I don't think at all that games should not be, like, should not be heavily authored or should or need to give you a whole varieties of possible outcomes. You know, I think that it's about how engaged you are with it. Did you see yourself in it? Did you see, because that's with Walking Dead, you know, like, many of those choices just fed back into themselves and didn't really, you know, like, have an impact on the story, so to speak. And yet, by having to choose them before I even made that choice, before that narrative arc was resolved, just by having to make that choice, I had to understand something about myself and about how I respond to difficult situations. And that's very heavily authored, but that still gave me room to feel a sense of influence over the story and, like, over myself, you know?
And so what about something that is a little bit less or more limited in its amount of choice, but is still trying to preach something about video game narration, sort of like BioShock?
Sure. I mean, it's apples to oranges, right? Like, a BioShock succeeds in many ways, and it falls short in many ways. I mean, if you mean specifically about, like, the twist in BioShock, like, how effective is that? I mean, is that what you're...
BioShock is in a way trying to do a similar thing to what you're trying to do, in that it's attempting to make a commentary on why players follow orders or don't follow orders.
Yeah, but you know, I'll tell you what I love Bioshock, right? And it really doesn't have that much to do with that twist. I love Bioshock because I think it's a compelling and engaging game, right?
Same.
I'll tell you what, I loved playing Bioshock, you know, and I loved playing Bioshock before I got to that point where it where that twist happened, right? And that twist was interesting to me, but it was not the game, right? The experience was I played a great game that I really loved. And I hope with Stanley Parable, people can just play a game that they enjoyed. And if they get all the philosophical stuff out of it, then awesome. You know, I think that engagement and people questioning themselves and people questioning video games and questioning narrative can happen in so many ways without it being like explicitly brought up that I don't think it's not very interesting for me to call attention to those specific little incidents because there's symptoms of many, many other games that are doing stuff like that all the time that are drawing attention to themselves and that are making little references and jabs at their own narrative and that are, you know, subverting themselves to understand. And you know, people talk about Bioshock because it was so explicit. It just put it right out there, put it in front of everyone and in such a big way, you know? I would rather not create the assumption that that very like explicit surface level way of doing that is like the only way to do it. You know, people talk about Bioshock as though, or like Spec Ops: The Line, as though those are the only games that are doing it. But games do that all the time in lots of little tiny ways. You know, and it's all over the place if you just pay attention. And so I would like to diffuse the conversation out a little bit and spread it out apply to the broad spectrum of ways in which games do that kind of thing.
Okay, so, I mean, to get a little bit more, I don't want to talk about...
It was a really non-answer. I really didn't answer your question at all. I'm realizing now. I feel like I should apologize for not actually saying anything that you asked me about.
Well, I mean, that's your stance on it. The fact that you don't really think that it sort of affects... anything in the games industry is your answer.
But I don't think it's as meaningful as people make it out to be. I think that it's a convenient hook. You know, if you want something to latch onto and to be like, look at this, this is an example of blah. If you want to be able to do that, then great, Bioshock is your hook. If you want, like, continual little, very real, because of how invisible they are, subversions of narrative, you know, that are real because they don't draw attention to themselves. And not that Bioshock, like, isn't real or whatever, but I'm saying they're all over the place. And it, to me, it sort of cheapens the conversation to say that any one game is more exemplary of that when I feel like every game has a little something to say about it.
Okay. So I didn't really want to talk about the fact that there's, like, all these multiple endings where, you know, you sort of get completely different outcomes based on what they are, but can you sort of talk about, you know, how many endings the game ended up with, number one, and why you sort of arrived at that number?
Well, there's 6 endings in the original game, and I sat down to try to think of every little way that I could subvert player expectations and condense them into down into specific endings if they happen to overlap, if little things seem to fit together, I'd put them together, and just at the end of that process, I had 6 endings, and that was it. I got that far, and I said, okay, I'm done.
Okay. That's a clear answer. all right, so, you know, Stanley Parable, you can get it on ModDB once again, and it's a really interesting game sort of exploring all of these themes that you've just heard. So, yeah, you've played it. Maybe now you'll have a different perspective playing it again. And thanks for listening, and thanks so much for taking the time, really.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to get to talk about stuff like this.
Thank you for listening to these IndieCade East 2013 special features. If you like what you heard, make sure to check out the accompanying coverage over at PressPlayTV.com. You can also subscribe to our podcast on iTunes if you want to hear all this stuff as it comes out. So you can find that on iTunes under the Press Play Podcast. Thanks for listening, guys.